pro, I was interested in fighting. I just wanted to fight, train hard and fight.
And so I'm not having it, you're 51.
Yeah, so don't tell anybody. Unfortunately.
But we still make like middle cut.
Yeah, of course. Comfortable. I had an experiment with the lads the other day when I've got more training. And I got down to 10-10. And they couldn't believe me. They said, how have you done that? And I was just telling them how the way to eat healthy. It can be done. You can still do it. Yeah. Have you started?
Yeah. It's all right. This is not an interview with an up-and-coming prospect in the light middleweight division, is it? Just so everyone knows. Ensley was born in Manchester in 1961.
Yes, 61. That's correct.
Did you, as a child, did boxing come into your life at that time?
Oh, never. As a young child, I was a very sickly kid. Believe it or not, when I was born, they gave me 24 hours to live. And I said to Mum, he's not going to make it. The lungs weren't developed and I wasn't breathing on my own. See, Mum? I was struggling to breathe, and he says, whatever you're going to do, you need to name the child and get the priest in to give the last rites over the child because he's not going to make it through the night. Mum was shocked, obviously, as you would imagine. And, you know, they just said all the prayers and I made it through the first night. Then the second night, got stronger and stronger. But I was always a sickly, sickly child. I'm talking about walking from here to the front door and I'll be my lungs didn't develop very well, unfortunately. And I had a lot of problems, breathing problems.
When was your first experience of boxing and when did you go into that?
My first experience of boxing must have been about 16 and a half. When I was I'd gone away from home, I'd left home and I moved up to a place called Stockton-on-Tees to do an engineering course. And it was there that I went into the gym and I tried to do a little bit of boxing. I remember the trainer at the time took all the lads out for a run and they all ran away and left me. And I was in a heap on the floor trying to breathe to get some oxygen in my system so I could get back home. It was quite comical.
You started your amateur career then, it was at the College of Moston in North Manchester with Brian Hughes.
That's right.
How did that come about? Was you in the area then or living up there?
How that came about is that I was just keeping fit generally because we spoke to a specialist about my health conditions and they said if I could get involved in some kind of a sporting activity that would help my lungs to develop because of breathing and working harder. So there's a fella that was going to the gym in the first place, he lives on the bottom of our street, called Danny Lawford. He was a light heavyweight, in the light heavyweight division. And he took me down one evening, and just started from there. Just started to go everything. I was still working. I was doing engineering. And I used to just go down on the evening time and just do some training. And Brian said to me a couple of times that, I had a pretty good punch, pretty stiff left hook, and I should be concentrating on doing some amateur boxing. I thought, yeah, I bet you say that to everybody, Brian. Anyway, I carried on training and it turned out that, Brian got me back into the amateur boxing and it worked pretty good.
You won your first 11 amateur fights by knockout, is that correct?
That's right. And then I think I lost my first one to an Irish team that came over. Yeah.
I know you lost one of your first, I don't know if it was your first, but Errol Christie.
Yes. No, I'd lost one before that, yeah. But that was another loss that I had. I boxed Errol Christie in the NACB Championships in Coventry, and I remember at the time he was this really talented individual that everybody was raving about. He'd run the NACB tournament a couple of times, and it was a tough fight. I mean, as you know, my style was never really suited to the amateurs. I was more of a taking my time, slipping, sliding. I wasn't a very busy fighter at all. So the amateur style didn't suit me, but I managed to catch up with Errol Christie in the third round and I caught him with a good body shot and that slowed him down a bit. And I tried to nail him with a left hook, but he was a little bit too slick and he managed to get away from me and he beat me on points.
It's interesting that he said, obviously you're renowned for the bingo left hook, we'll get to that in a bit, but when you first started with Brian at the Colliest, you're actually left-handed, but you ended up fighting from there on in as an orthodox.
Yeah, that was crazy. I've gone down to the gym and I've seen everybody standing with, you know, in their orthodox stance. So obviously they're right-handed. I just stood in the same stance and carried on doing what I was doing and I got used to it. So when eventually I realised, oh, I should be standing the other way, and I tried it, it didn't feel comfortable and I was getting whacked every time I sparred. But no, don't need to do this, let me go back to the orthodox way. And it served me for good purpose really, because I was able to get that left hook off really quickly and sharp, and I was able to throw it very naturally, very hard. So I just use it to my advantage over the years.
I know one of the things, having spoke to Brian, what he took you and I think it was Lance Williams over to America, yeah, to train with Manuel Stewart in the Kronk's gym. That was just before you turned pro, so I mean, well, that was some special experience for you, something that stood you in good stead for your career.
It was an incredible experience. Just seeing how the Americans trained and how, you know, Emmanuel Stewart, you know, conducted himself around his fighters and how he treated us as visitors was amazing. I managed to get a couple of rounds sparring with a fellow called Lindell Holmes, who eventually went on to box Marvin Hagler for the middleweight title of the world. And at the time, they had an up-and-coming young kid called Frank Tate, who then, after I left there, went on to win the Olympics and then turned pro and was very successful as well. But there was a number of young fighters in the gym that was just incredible. Young Stephen McCrory, Milt McCrory, Caveman Lee, Mickey Goodwin. You know, there's a load of incredible.
Great Thomas Hearns himself.
The great man Tommy Hitman Hearns himself was an incredible experience. When we was in the gym and to see how these guys was performing and to say that how we came from England and we would do so much more physical hard work, whereas these guys would just make it look so easy. You know, watching Tommy and sparring in the early days, it was like watching poetry in motion. You know, he's just his movement, his sharpness, his, you know, accuracy is incredible. But I'll be honest with you, at the time he was over there, he wasn't even rated the number one in the gym. And little Stephen McCrory was the number one fighter. It was very, very difficult to hit. He'd stand in front of you and you wouldn't be able to hit him, even if you throw, you know, a handful of salt on him. He'd miss his slip and dodge and weave and incredible talent. It was a fantastic experience.
I think while you was there as well, you told me before you ended up, you was there when Thomas Hearns and Sugar Ray Leonard signed for the first
fight.
That's right,
that was crazy. We just finished a training session and then Manny Stewart said that he's going over to this restaurant to sign the papers for Tommy to fight Sugar Ray. So I said, you can all come over if you want. So I thought, we're not going to get him, he wasn't dressed properly or nothing, you know. But Manny Stewart went over and spoke to the hotel people. And they managed to get us in and we sat at the table. I can remember I had frog's legs that day. The first time I ever had frog legs with salads and chips. It was incredible. Yeah, it was nice.
Special times.
When you look back at them times and the experience that it gave me, and you know, different ways of different people do the boxing training was incredible. Very, very good.
And Ensley, you did eventually turn pro in 1996. You won your first two knockouts, and then in your fifth fight, premature, like looking back on it, I think you went in with Clinton McKenzie, who, you know, 30 odd fights at the time.
Yeah.
And then after that, I think Costas Petru was it, and then Gary Cooper. They were three losses after them first four wins, but he was, safe to say, he was pretty much out of your depth, really. I mean, had only four pro fights. You know, did you think?
Well, you know, looking at it on paper, when you read through the lines like that, he says, yeah, it looks like I was out of my depth. But Phil Martin put me in them fights at the time because he believed I could win them. He studied boxing and he studied these guys and he knew what I could do. And he believed that with my talent and my desire and my hunger, that I was able I'd stand me all my own, or I'd start get a win off these kids at the time. So it was crazy. It was almost like a suicidal baptism, but it was something that we did. And at the end of it all. I climbed the ratings, and you know, after them three losses, I think I was number two or number three in the light middleweight divisions at the time.
gets the taste again. Can he make it, I wonder? He fights Manchester's Ensley Bingham, unbeaten in four fights, but a man who was forced to take a 30-month layoff when he broke a wrist.
Here we go. McKenzie, always beautifully balanced and light on his feet. No count there. Just a little tumble. Fox on, says Larry O'Connell. But Ensley Bingham still giving an excellent account of himself. Point you want to make, Alan?
I was going to say, you know, although it wasn't a punch and he went on the floor, it's very heartbreaking to a fighter. Although it's a trick, it still livens up the opponent. He thinks, oh, he's on the floor, I must have a decent chance.
Last 30 seconds. And Bingham, what a brave man. A little shuffle from him too. But I think that's a bit of kidology, possibly to attract the eyes of referee Larry O'Connell. Three southpaw jabs coming from McKenzie. And the applause breaks out all around us. And this has been a very enjoyable late rounder indeed. And a lot of people will be sad that it's all over. It's been a really good one, and McKenzie's got it. Definitely the right verdict. Tremendous exhibition from Fintan McKenzie. Started slowly, got better and best any time. His first defeat in five fights. He'll have learnt a massive amount tonight.
You know, experiencing some tough fighters at that time early on in your career, yeah, it definitely gave you a good grounding in the pros.
Well, you know, it's something I just took in stride, because when we're training down here, it was tough anyway. So it wasn't like I was doing anything different from what I did in the gym. You know, when you think about it, I was taught sparring, I'm working with Tony Kubia, Maurice Coe, Frank Grant, Paul Burke, you know, the list is endless. A kid called Quinn Painter, another guy called Frank Eubank. Now, these guys could all punch. These were punchers, you know. You couldn't stand in front of Quinn Painter and not get, you know, winged with a big shot. Frank Eubank was the heaviest hitting person that I've ever sparred with. Maurice Coe was tall and slick, and they had that long jabs and long range. And you had Frank Grant, who was another one, he was a busy fighter. And then Tony Kubia, he was as tough as nails, his skin was like leather, but he was a tough old guy. And Paul Burke was very sharp, and he was former British champion, so...
So he's having some battles in the gym.
Yeah, for me to go into them type of fights and people think, oh God, I can't on my own. They, you know, they weren't aware of what we was doing in the gym and the way we was training, and, you know, it was too soon for on paper to say to be fighting these guys with so much more experience, but in terms of what I was able to do, I don't think it was too soon at all. It worked out fine.
Well, yeah, it probably gave you, you know, the level that you had to raise your game to, didn't it? Rather than having a load of, you know, 10, 15 easy journeyman fights, you knew it gave you knew what you had to do to make it in the pros. So.
When I've gone into the pros, I've always had this this mental attitude. I've got to do what I've got to do to win this fight. You know what I'm saying?
Ensley, just, you know, going back a bit there, you said about you turning pro, but you was with Brian Hughes as an amateur, and then you mentioned Phil Martin, and you come over to Champs Camp in my side. How did you first meet Phil?
Gosh, I can't remember now. I think I just came down here. I'd left Colliers. I mean, Brian and I fell out, to be honest. We just fell out. We seen difference of opinion. After I came back from Denmark, I think it was, we just didn't seem to see eye to eye anymore, and said, well, let bygones be bygones, and I'm going to go back to my engineering and do what I've got to do. And then I just was keeping fit, and I managed to come down to the massage gym. Got talking to the lads, and just decided I would come down here and do some training. Phil Martin convinced me that I've got a lot of ability and I should carry on boxing, and then I started to box here as an amateur.
Hard baptism, as you say, in the pro ranks. You went into another hard fight with Wally Swift. I remember that fight. Well, 10 rounds. You fought him twice, but the first one, it was a 10-round war, a bloody war as well.
Yeah.
Do you remember that one quite vividly?
Very well. I remember the training for the fight was really, really tough. And believe it or not, on the Sunday before one of our hard training sessions, training for the fight, I actually got married. It was a crazy time, because I got married on the Saturday, and we spent our a wedding night in the hotel suite, and I left the hotel suite to go and do the training at Chalk Marina with the boys, and that was one killer session, I swear, and that was 2 weeks before the fight. I remember doing that. But the reason why we got married on that particular day when it was so close to the fight was it was a date that we'd always have in our minds, is say the 9th of the 9th would be the day we would get married, because it was a day that we'd have to separate when I was leaving to go away somewhere to do some engineering. So it was a date that we had to use as our wedding date. So it just happened to be that I was fighting 2 weeks after that.
1, 2, 3. See, I was getting shorter and shorter for Quinton and Clive.
Yep.
Right, but they're leaving itself out a bit. Keep it going. Keep it going. Last 10 seconds, Ensley!
They're not sprinting though, Phil.
Go! Sprint! That used to walk. Come on, Steve Foster! Walk, Murray. Come on, Quinton! One! Come on, let's go! One! Two! So they all want to now start just stopping and all this of it. Go win a title like that.
What do you remember that fight? It was tough, Wally, wasn't it?
Yeah, he was tough. I remember he was very, very sharp. He wasn't a big puncher, Wally, but he was a very sharp, crisp puncher.
Here we go then for the chief supporting contest of the evening and the one I've come to see. An official eliminator for the light middleweight championship of Great Britain with his back to me. Wally Swift from Nottingham against Manchester's Ensley Bingham. This 10 rounds. And this an intriguing encounter.
He had good movement. He used his feet well. He was well schooled. And he was very crisp and sharp and very durable. I remember catching him in the middle of the fight with some really big left hooks. And he seemed to stop him in his tracks for seconds, but then he just come fighting back all the way through the fight. And he went the full distance, and I managed to win it by half a point on the 10 rounds, over the 10 rounds, yeah.
But Swift took it all, come blazing back. Ooh, a good right there from Bingham, that's hurt, Wally. And he's got one of the best guys in the country for recuperating after he's been hurt. That's what the sea is, good right there from Swift. And now the boots on the other. And this is one of those fights that people will talk about for years.
After the rematch with Wally, and you both got just desserts after the first war that you had. You both, it was the British title on the line.
Yeah, that came about because I managed to get myself in the number one position to fight Gary Stretch. Gary Stretch was the champion at the time, and he went on for a few months where Gary Stretch wasn't sure what he was doing, whether he's moving up to middleweight or whatever, going to defend the light middleweight title. And eventually he turned around and he couldn't make the weight anymore, and he moved up to middleweight and he vacated the title. So when the title became vacant, we then had to find someone to fight. We was going to try and fight Andy Till at the time, but for some reason the board wouldn't recognise him, and Wally Swift's just been an eliminator with myself earlier that I won. So we said that Wally Swift would be acceptable. So I ended up fighting Wally Swift in Birmingham, I think it was.
Yeah.
19th of March.
Fight, you lost in the fourth round, but going into it you had a lot of things going on. I had
a lot of problems going into it, but even though I had all the problems, I didn't think that I was going into the fight any less prepared. I still felt I was fully prepared for the fight of that nature, and went into the fight confident. I mean, the first round was pretty good, quite even, and I was catching him with good shots. The second round I managed to get caught with a little nick under the left eye. And then, obviously, with the nick, Phil Martin believed that the fight would be stopped. So he encouraged me to go out there and try to blast Wally out, to give him some, you know, big shots to try to get a stoppage, to force a stoppage. And unfortunately, in trying to do that, I walked onto one of Wally's very, very sharp right hands, right on the point of the chin. I remember sinking to my feet, and as I got back up, I'm looking out into the audience, I could see the family, and I'm waving to the family. So for sure, if I'm doing that, I can't be fully, you know, aware of where I was or what I was doing. And the referee stopped the fight, so it was justified. And a lot of ill feeling and bad feeling came back to me, you know, over mum's death and all that, after the loss, because it was another massive thing in my life, losing the British title.
The emotions come out then.
The emotions, yeah, very emotional, and I was pretty upset for a couple of months. Nobody could console me. My wife could not put her arm around me. I didn't want to know. I wanted to be on my own for a long time. And I think it was Billy Graham who eventually got to me, and he said, look, you know, if you're going to call it a day, there's a lot more you could achieve in this game, because you're a talented person, a talented individual. You've got a lot of good qualities. Come on, let's get back into training. And after that chat with Billy, we set another path to try to get the British title. And I had three fights back, three knockouts. Then I got with Frank Warren. I had another fight just before that. I boxed a kid called Mark McCreath in Bristol. And that was funny, but that was a fight that opened a lot of doors for me, actually. Because I've gone down to fight Mark McCreath in Bristol, weighing in at 10 stone 10. Now, I got down there and jumped on the scales, and I was bang on 10 stone 10. It was something I was quite good at, making sure I was fit, strong, and on the weight. I was able to do that quite well. We got down there now, and Brendan Ingalls, lad, jumped on the scale, and he's 10 stone 6. So Brendan made out that, oh, the fight's not going to happen, I'm too heavy. I've got to take off another 3 pounds. So he made, well, they never made me, but they suggested to me that, you know, if you take off another 3 pounds, the fight could happen, but if you don't, there'd be no fight. And I trained hard for the fight. And then, you know, they only gave me a 1 week's notice, believe it or not, but in that 1 week, we got a lot of work in, and I got myself in good shape. So we eventually took the 3 pounds off. I weighed in at 10 stone 7, dead as a doornail on the day of the fight, on the weighing of the fight. Absolutely. And Brendan, I remember Brendan Ingle laughing at us, thinking, oh, we've got you now. He'll be weak as a kitten. You'll be able to blow him over with a feather tomorrow. And he went off laughing. So I thought, yeah, bugger. You know, kindest kind of words. And I had to properly rehydrate myself that evening. And I remember going to an Italian restaurant about 1 o'clock in the morning, just to make sure I got all the food I could get on board. And I managed to put on so much pasta, I ate so much pasta and drank so much water, that by the time I went to the fight venue the next day, I was 11 stone 6. I weighed 10 stone 7 the night before. So I felt great, and in the end, the fight spoke for itself. I knocked Mark McCreath out in 2 rounds, caught him with a wicked left hook, so...
It worked
really well.
From Manchester, Ensley Bingham. At the weigh-in, McCreath scale 10 stone 5 pounds, Bingham 10 stone 7 pounds. Your referee for this contest, Mr. Grant Wallace.
Well, this might be quite an interesting fight. Ensley Bingham, who's coming off a very, very good win against Kevin Adamson, the former Commonwealth title contender. That was in February. He knocked him out in 5 rounds. He's been a British title contender in the past. Up against Mark McCreath from Lincoln. He also fought Pat Barrett for the European Championship, lost that in 6 rounds, but had Barrett on the floor, and it was quite close for a while there.
Right.
Oh, left hook, look at that. There's Bingham's power for you. McCreath somehow got up smiling. I don't quite know or think he knows quite where he is, McCreath.
Nine.
No, stopped, and that's a good decision. Good decision by the referee, Grant Wallace. McCreath had a kind of silly grin on his face. It was almost frightening and alarming, the look he had on his face. I thought for a moment that he thought he'd been hit by some kind of sucker shot and was going to get up, but no, it was more than that. He was all over the place, and Bingham, well, we told you he had a punch, and the punch paid, and Bingham has a second round stoppage win over Mark McCree. Good win for him. What a punch.
Very good win. Very good performance. He needed to do a little bit more, and he did just the right thing. We said he had that very good left hook. McCree was very relaxed, very casual about it, and there, the left hook. Look at the power. Just nipped round. McCree had his right hand, but just nipped round the corner of that. Bang on the button.
Terrific shot from Bingham, who is probably going to be campaigning, we hear, as a welterweight now. And look at McCree there, laid flat out. There's a really, look at that. Ooh, you won't see many better punches than that.
In my eyes, you're a real sort of pro's pro. You've been around, you've seen it all, you've done it all, and you deserve to get something from this game. So you just got to stick at it, haven't you?
Well, that's right. But I'm going to stick at it until I become champion. I'm going to be a champion.
Well, let's hope so. I'm with you anyway.
Thank you.
Really disappointed after that second Wally Swift fight, because obviously the British title was on the line. It was a dream of yours to win and add another one to the great fighters who were in the championship at the time. But it was to come. Another tough fight before that, Robert McCracken. I mean, Robert went on to prove himself a quality fighter. I think he was 12-0 at the time when you fought him.
Yeah,
it was some hell of a fight, if I remember it.
So there's Ensley Bingham, then champs count written on the bottom of those trunks. And there's Rob McCracken, got a lot of support here.
The training for the McCracken fight didn't go according to plan, believe it or not. We had all kinds of headaches for that. For some reason, Phil Martin thought it would be a good idea to bring in the kid who McCracken fought in his last fight, who was nothing like McCracken. So it was counterproductive, as it turned out, because the kid was a southpaw, and Phil wanted me to spar with the southpaw. I think it was 3 days before the McCracken fight, I was sparring with this kid because McCracken. So I think we got something completely wrong on that one, and it just took away all the good work I'd done for the fight by me sparring 3 days before fighting McCracken with a southpaw. He was a horrible southpaw, as it happened. So I don't think I went into the fight as prepared as best as I could have done. I remember at the time as well, we was in some disagreements with Phil, and my weight was really low. I weighed in on the day. That's when they had on the day weigh-ins. So I weighed in at 1 o'clock, 10 stone 12. And obviously I could have been up to 11 stone for the light middleweight division. So I was £2 under my weight limit, which is something I'd never done before. So you could see that things weren't quite right with the whole thing. I'd left a lot of training in the gym for that fight, and it's shown in the fight, actually.
And this is lovely left hook from Ensley Bingham. That's what I expected. Cracking punch from Bingham. McCracken badly shaken by that. Oh, and again Bingham catches him. The right hand that time from Ensley Bingham.
I still managed to catch Robert with a wicked left hook. I can remember, looking back, I can remember he set about me with bad intentions for that first round, and he was a tall, rangy, long, you know, he had an incredible jab, and his right cross was dangerous. And I can remember the fight now. In the first round, he'd backed me up to the corner, and I was bobbing, weaving, slipping, ducking and diving, trying to survive. And all of a sudden, I've just sprung this massive left hook from way down in my boots and caught Robert as he was coming in right on the chain, and he went down. And he went down like a sack of potatoes.
And Bingham has already boxed once for the British Light Middleweight Championship, was stopped in four rounds on his feet by Wally Swift. So a good start this then for Ensley Bingham, the man from Manchester, in the gold trunks, and again the left hook. And again a big shot there, jerks back McCracken's head. Referee Dave Parrish trying hard to pull off McCracken. Very sensibly trying to grab hold there. Can Ensley Bingham find the right punches to finish this one? McCracken though, a very gritty performer. Once again, Bingham getting on top with some long punches, head and body. McCracken not fully over yet, that left hand that put him on the floor. And of course the follow-up punches, but now McCracken tries to come back. Can McCracken get through this last 15 seconds or so? And again, Bingham there teed up the left hook. Well, it's a good round for Ensley Bingham.
How he got up and climbed to the top of that ropes to get up to stand up before that 10 count, I just don't know how he did. And he himself said, if I speak to him today, he says he doesn't know. He's never been hit as hard by anybody since that day. I caught him with that good left hook. Unfortunately, it was about one of the highlights of the fight because I tried chasing after him after that. My whole fight plan changed when I caught him. I knew I could hurt him. So rather than trying to box and catch him again, I just went hunting for that big left hook. And I think it was round five, I caught him again and I rocked him all over the place, but he just held on again, didn't quite go. And each time I was trying to force it and force it and force it. And eventually I ran out of steam. And I remember he caught me with a wicked right hand to the top of the temple in the 10th round. It was only a 10 rounder. And he just stunned me. And I never went down, but my body just went limp. And he caught me with a ricochet, and body went limp, and I just stood there. And Robert came to hit me again, and he realised I was gone. And he just turned away, and then the referee jumped in and stopped the fight.
Ooh, and a hard right there. Bingham's in big trouble. And referee Dave Paris has stopped it. McCracken cracked him with the right hand. Bingham didn't go over. He just swayed like a tree in the breeze. It's all over. McCracken gets the chance to fight for the British Championship. He might have to face either Sean Cummins or Martin Smith, the winner of the next eliminator, or he might just get himself a straight crack at the British titleist, Andy Till.
I think it was about a minute to go in the last round. But I think I would have lost it on points, I think. I think he did outpoint me towards the end. I caught him with some cracking shots, but not enough to win the fight.
I think it was safe to say that was his Robert's baptism of fire in the pro game at that time, wasn't it? It was his toughest fight to date. He went on to do really well, didn't he?
Yeah, he did very well. I think he won the long tail belt outright quite shortly after that. And then he went to the States, and then he moved up to middleweight. Yeah, but he's still a good pal of mine, Robert, and he did really well as a pro.
Now you're both coaches.
Now we're both coaches,
After that fight and that period, like the next 3 years, it was pretty stop and start, and then you had a lot of hand injuries as well. Was that the main reason for keeping you out of the ring at that time?
Well, believe it or not, my hand injury started from before I turned pro. Before I even turned pro, I damaged my scaphoid. I'd ruptured ligaments holding the scaphoid. And I had to have a major operation to just use the hand normally again, never mind to box with it. All the boxing fraternity people said I'd never box with the hand, he'd never be strong enough because of the injury I sustained. But I met some good people, and the fellow who did the operation, Mr. Frank, was really good. A fellow called Peter Schofield, who was my physio, fantastic fellow. And if it wasn't for him, Peter Schofield, I would never have achieved half of what I achieved. So I'm very grateful to him, which I've told him many times, and he came to a number of my fights after that. So
during that period, and so that 3 years, Phil Martin died in 1994. He was the founder of Champs Camp, and obviously you've gone through your career with you. I know you was not with Phil at that time.
We knew that Phil was poorly, and we knew that he didn't have long. At the time, when we found out, they said he might be able to live 12 months. Unfortunately, I think it was only about 4 or 5 months that he lived. I'll never forget the day that I heard, because I got a phone call. I was working on a building site doing some labouring for a pal of mine. And I got a phone call saying that Phil Martin died this afternoon at 3 o'clock. And the day was the 27th of May, 94. It was my birthday. Yeah. So, you know, it was one of those things that, you know, Phil passed away at 3 o'clock that particular day, and it was a birthday of mine, so it's a day I will never forget. Phil was creative in the sense that he had a vision that he could be, you know, a top trainer. And he worked hard to do that. And at the time, we had four British champions at the gym: Paul Burke, lightweight; Frank Grant, middleweight; Morris Court, light heavy; and Carl Thompson, cruiserweight. And we had the four champions, and I was due to fight. I just lost to Wally Swift, I think, at the time. So, you know, we could have had five champions in the gym at one time. And to say that we had four in the first place has never been done before, and never been done since, where we've had four British champions in the same gym. So, you know, it was an incredible achievement for Phil and the boys that were doing the boxing at the time.
It was, because he'd opened the gym in the 80s, wasn't it? Just like 81. After the riots and that's stuff right. like that. So, you know, the area, Moss Side, it really needed something like that. And it took an awful lot of the kids and people, maybe wayward strays, off the street and into it, didn't it?
Yeah, if you look at some of the pictures of us all the lads that were actively in the gym also helped to build the gym. You know, we had carpenters doing carpentry, we had bricklayers doing bricky work, we had a lot of lads just doing labouring. And we all just worked together and just created an incredible gym, as you can see.
Everyone chips in.
Yeah.
So you did the welding.
I did. Yeah, I built the ring that you've been, your training. I built that with my steelwork and stuff and welding and all that.
Is it important to you now, Leon, you and Morris are continuing that legacy that Phil started here? And you know, you've named the gym now the Phil Martin Centre, so you know his name's always going to be there. And
it's important that we try to carry on something along them lines here. The way we train the fighters has changed a lot, and the different things we do here has changed. The amateurs have changed, boxing's changed. So yeah, we're trying to keep things going here and develop young fighters, which is good.
Ensley's had to cope with the deaths of former trainer Phil Martin and his mother during his career. The man who's helped him through is friend and trainer Billy Graham.
Billy's been there, you know, when you've had them down moments, just to bring you back up and to get you back in the gym, because we all go through bad periods there, you know, things are not going right and you just want to just get away from it. Billy's been a big inspiration to me in my boxing career. Just being there when you needed someone just to say, well, come on, you're good enough, and you know you're good enough to continue. And at the end of the day, I'm back here again in this position fighting for the British title.
And across the ring, ladies and gentlemen, in the blue corner, we're in the burgundy trunks, and coming from Manchester, he weighed in at exactly 11 stone. He has had 19 professional contests, 13 wins, 9 wins by way of KO with 6 losses. He's a former British title contender. Ladies and gentlemen, Ensley Bingo Bingham!
There was a lot of people there supporting me that night, just in my own family, let alone friends and other people. So it was a fantastic night, and to have your hand raised to say, and the new British light middleweight, it was incredible. The fight with Winky, I mean, I fought out my socks, I fought as best as I could fight. Winky was very, very cautious in the fight. Bingo, he said, you just have to grit your teeth and give hell for leather, just throw all kinds of shots at him. So I remember it was the 12th and final round, and I knew I was well behind on points, I had to knock him out to win. And I managed to muster up the energy and the strength to throw an almighty left hook.
This is your music, guys.